A Millionaire of Rough and Ready. By Bret Harte. Podcast 1 of 3. Prologue. There was no mistake this time, he had struck gold at last. It had lain there before him a moment ago, a misshapen piece of brown-stained quartz, interspersed with dull yellow metal, yielding enough to have allowed the points of his pick to penetrate its honeycombed recesses, yet heavy enough to drop from the point of his pick as he endeavored to lift it from the red earth. He was seeing all this plainly, although he found himself, he knew not why, at some distance from the scene of his discovery, his heart foolishly beating, his breath impotently hurried. Yet he was walking slowly and vaguely, conscious of stopping and staring at the landscape, which no longer looked familiar to him. He was hoping for some instinct or force of habit to recall him to himself, yet when he saw a neighbor at work in an adjacent claim, he hesitated, and then turned his back upon him. Yet only a moment before he had thought of running to him, saying, "By jingo! I've struck it, or dn it, old man, I've got it," but that moment had passed, and now it seemed to him that he could scarce raise his voice, or, if he did, the ejaculation would appear forced and artificial. Neither could he go over to him coolly and tell his good fortune, and, partly from this strange shyness, and partly with the hope that another survey of the treasure might restore him to natural expression, he walked back to his tunnel. Yes, it was there. No mere pocket or deposit, but a part of the actual vein he had been so long seeking. It was there, sure enough, lying beside the pick and the debris of the face of the vein that he had exposed sufficiently, after the first shock of discovery, to assure himself of the fact and the permanence of his fortune. It was there, and with it the refutation of his enemy's sneers, the corroboration of his friend's belief, the practical demonstration of his own theories, the reward of his patient labors. It was there, sure enough. But, somehow, he not only failed to recall the first joy of discovery, but was conscious of a vague sense of responsibility and unrest. It was, no doubt, an enormous fortune to a man in his circumstances. Perhaps it meant a couple of $100,000, or more, judging from the value of the old Martin lead, which was not as rich as this, but it required to be worked constantly and judiciously. It was with a decided sense of uneasiness that he again sought the open sunlight of the hillside. His neighbor was still visible on the adjacent claim, but he had apparently stopped working, and was contemplatively smoking a pipe under a large pine tree. For an instant he envied him his apparent contentment. He had a sudden fierce and inexplicable desire to go over to him and exasperate his easy poverty by a revelation of his own newfound treasure. But even that sensation quickly passed, and left him staring blankly at the landscape again. As soon as he had made his discovery known, and settled its value, he would send for his wife and her children in the States. He would build a fine house on the opposite hillside, if she would consent to it, unless she preferred, for the children's sake, to live in San Francisco. A sense of a loss of independence, of a change of circumstances that left him no longer his own master, began to perplex him, in the midst of his brightest projects. Certain other relations with other members of his family, which had lapsed by absence and his insignificance, must now be taken up anew. He must do something for his sister Jane, for his brother William, for his wife's poor connections. It would be unfair to him to say that he contemplated those things with any other instinct than that of generosity, yet he was conscious of being already perplexed and puzzled. Meantime, however, the neighbor had apparently finished his pipe, and, knocking the ashes out of it, rose suddenly, and ended any further uncertainty of their meeting by walking over directly towards him. The treasure finder advanced a few steps on his side, and then stopped irresolutely. "Hollow, Slyn," said the neighbor, confidently. "Hollow, Masters," responded Slyn, faintly. From the sound of the two voices a stranger might have mistaken their relative condition. "What in thunder are you mooning about for? What's up?" Then, catching sight of Slyn's pale and anxious face, he added abruptly, "Are you sick?" Slyn was on the point of telling him his good fortune, but stopped. The unlucky question confirmed his consciousness of his physical and mental disturbance, and he dreaded the ready ridicule of his companion. He would tell him later, masters need not know when he had made the strike. Besides, in his present vagueness, he shrank from the brusque, practical questioning that would be sure to follow the revelation to a man of master's temperament. I'm a little giddy here, he answered, putting his hand to his head, and I thought I'd knock off until I was better. Masters examined him with two very critical gray eyes. Tell ye what, old man, if you don't quit this doggone fooling of yours in that godforsaken tunnel you'll get loony. Times you get so tangled up in fool errand that blind lead o' yours you ain't sensible. Here was the opportunity to tell him all, and vindicate the justice of his theories. But he shrank from it again, and now, adding to the confusion, was a singular sense of dread at the mental labor of explanation. He only smiled painfully, and began to move away. Look you, said Masters, peremptorily, ye want about 3 fingers of straight whiskey to set you right, and you've got to take it with me. D-n it, man, it may be the last drink we take together. Don't look so scared. I mean I made up my mind about 10 minutes ago to cut the whole DD thing, and light out for fresh diggings. I'm sick of getting only grub wages out o' this bill. So that's what I mean by saying it's the last drink you and me'll take together. You know my ways, sayin' and doin' with me's the same thing. It was true. Slynn had often envied Master's promptness of decision and resolution. But he only looked at the grim face of his interlocutor with a feeble sense of relief. He was going. And he, Slynn, would not have to explain anything. He murmured something about having to go over to the settlement on business. He dreaded lest Masters should insist upon going into the tunnel. I suppose you want to mail that letter, said Masters, drily. The mail don't go till tomorrow, so you've got time to finish it, and put it in an envelope. Following the direction of Master's eyes, Slynn looked down and saw, to his utter surprise, that he was holding an unfinished penciled note in his hand. How it came there, when he had written it, he could not tell. He dimly remembered that one of his first impulses was to write to his wife, but that he had already done so he had forgotten. He hastily concealed the note in his breast pocket, with a vacant smile. Masters eyed him half contemptuously, half compassionately. Don't forget yourself and drop it in some hollow tree for a letterbox, be said. Well, so long, since you won't drink. Take care of yourself, and, turning on his heel, Masters walked away. Slynn watched him as he crossed over to his abandoned claim, saw him gather his few mining utensils, strap his blanket over his back, lift his hat on his long-handled shovel as a token of farewell, and then stride lightheartedly over the ridge. He was alone now with his secret and his treasure. The only man in the world who knew of the exact position of his tunnel had gone away forever. It was not likely that this chance companion of a few weeks would ever remember him or the locality again. He would now leave his treasure alone for even a day, perhaps until he had thought out some plan and sought out some friend in whom to confide. His secluded life, the singular habits of concentration which had at last proved so successful had, at the same time, left him few acquaintances and no associates. And in all his well-laid plans and patiently digested theories for finding the treasure, the means and methods of working it and disposing of it had never entered. And now, at the hour when he most needed his faculties, what was the meaning of this strange benumbing of them? Patience. He only wanted a little rest, a little time to recover himself. There was a large boulder under a tree in the highway of the settlement, a sheltered spot where he had often waited for the coming of the stagecoach. He would go there, and when he was sufficiently rested and composed he would go on. Nevertheless, on his way he diverged and turned into the woods, for no other apparent purpose than to find a hollow tree. A hollow tree. Yes. That was what Masters had said, he remembered it distinctly, and something was to be done there, but what it was, or why it should be done, he could not tell. However, it was done, and very luckily, for his limbs could scarcely support him further, and reaching that boulder he dropped upon it like another stone. And now, strange to say, the uneasiness and perplexity which had possessed him ever since he had stood before his revealed wealth dropped from him like a burden laid upon the wayside. A measureless peace stole over him, in which visions of his newfound fortune, no longer a trouble and perplexity, but crowned with happiness and blessing to all around him, assumed proportions far beyond his own weak, selfish plans. In its even-handed benefaction, his wife and children, his friends and relations, even his late poor companion of the hillside, met and moved harmoniously together. In its far-reaching consequences there was only the influence of good. It was not strange that this poor finite mind should never have conceived the meaning of the wealth extended to him, or that conceiving it he should faint and falter under the revelation. Enough that for a few minutes he must have tasted a joy of perfect anticipation that years of actual possession might never bring. The sun seemed to go down in a rosy dream of his own happiness, as he still sat there. Later, the shadows of the trees thickened and surrounded him, and still later fell the calm of a quiet evening sky with far-spaced passionless stars, that seemed as little troubled by what they looked upon as he was by the stealthy creeping life in the grasses and underbrush at his feet. The dull patter of soft little feet in the soft dust of the road, the gentle gleam of moist and wondering little eyes on the branches and in the mossy edges of the boulder, did not disturb him. He sat patiently through it all, as if he had not yet made up his mind. But when the stage came with the flashing sun the next morning, and the irresistible clamor of life and action, the driver suddenly laid his four spirited horses on their haunches before the quiet spot. The express messenger clambered down from the box, and approached what seemed to be a heap of cast-off clothes upon the boulder. "He don't seem to be drunk," he said, in reply to a querulous interrogation from the passengers. "I can't make him out. His eyes are open, but he cannot speak or move. Take a look at him, document." A rough unprofessional-looking man here descended from the inside of the coach, and, carelessly thrusting aside the other curious passengers, suddenly leaned over the heap of clothes in a professional attitude. "He is dead," said one of the passengers. The rough man let the passive head sink softly down again. "No such luck for him," he said curtly, but not unkindly. "It's a stroke of paralysis and about as big as they make 'em. It's a toss-up if he ever speaks or moves again as long as he lives." Chapter 1. When Alvin Mulratty announced his intention of growing potatoes and garden truck on the green slopes of Los Gatos, the mining community of that region, and the adjacent hamlet of Rough and Ready, regarded it with the contemptuous indifference usually shown by those adventurers towards all bucolic pursuits. There was certainly no active objection to the occupation of two hillsides, which gave so little promise to the prospector for gold that it was currently reported that a single prospector, called Slynn, had once gone mad or imbecile through repeated failures. The only opposition came, incongruously enough, from the original pastoral owner of the soil, one Don Ramon Alvarado, whose claim for 7 leagues of hill and valley, including the now prosperous towns of Rough and Ready and Red Dog, was met with simple derision from the squatters and miners. "Looks easy if we was goin' to travel 3,000 miles to open up his DD old wilderness, and then pay for the increased value we give it, don't it?" "Oh, yes, certainly," was their ironical commentary. Mulratty might have been pardoned for adopting this popular opinion, but by an equally incongruous sentiment, peculiar, however, to the man, he called upon Don Ramon, and actually offered to purchase the land, or go shares with him in the agricultural profits. It was alleged that the Don was so struck with this concession that he not only granted the land, but struck up a quaint reserved friendship for the simple-minded agriculturist and his family. It is scarcely necessary to add that this intimacy was viewed by the miners with the contempt that it deserved. They would have been more contemptuous, however, had they known the opinion that Don Ramon entertained of their particular vocation, and which he early confided to Mulratty. "They are savages who expect to reap where they have not sown, to take out of the earth without returning anything to it but their precious carcasses, heathens, who worship the mere stones they dig up." "And was there no Spaniard who ever dug gold?" asked Mulratty, simply. Ah, there are Spaniards and Moors, responded Don Ramon, sententiously. Gold has been dug, and by caballeros, but no good ever came of it. There were Alvarados in Sonora, look you, who had mines of silver, and worked them with peons and mules, and lost their money a gold mine to work a silver one like gentlemen. But this grubbing in the dirt with one's fingers, that a little gold may stick to them, is not for caballeros. And then, one says nothing of the curse. The curse, echoed Mary Mulratty, with youthful feminine superstition. What is that? You knew not, friend Mulratty, that when these lands were given to my ancestors by Charles V, the Bishop of Monterey laid a curse upon any who should desecrate them. Good. Let us see. Of the three Americanos who founded yonder town, one was shot, another died of a fever poisoned, you understand, by the soil, and the last got himself crazy of aguardiente. Even the Scientifico, who came here years ago and spied into the trees and the herbs, he was afterwards punished for his profanation, and died of an accident in other lands. But, added Don Ramon, with grave courtesy, this touches not yourself. Through me, you are of the soil. Indeed, it would seem as if a secure if not a rapid prosperity was the result of Don Ramon's manorial patronage. The potato patch and market garden flourished exceedingly, the rich soil responded with magnificent vagaries of growth, the even sunshine set the seasons at defiance with extraordinary and premature crops. The salt pork and biscuit-consuming settlers did not allow their contempt of Mulratty's occupation to prevent their profiting by this opportunity for changing their diet. The gold they had taken from the soil presently began to flow into his pockets in exchange for his more modest treasures. The little cabin, which barely sheltered his family a wife, son, and daughter was enlarged, extended, and refitted, but in turn abandoned for a more pretentious house on the opposite hill. A whitewashed fence replaced the rudely split rails, which had kept out the wilderness. By degrees, the first evidences of cultivation, the gashes of red soil, the piles of brush and undergrowth, the bared boulders, and heaps of stone melted away, and were lost under a carpet of lighter green, which made an oasis in the tawny desert of wild oats on the hillside. Water was the only free boon denied this Garden of Eden. What was necessary for irrigation had to be brought from a mining ditch at great expense, and was of insufficient quantity. In this emergency Mulratty thought of sinking an artesian well on the sunny slope beside his house, not, however, without serious consultation and much objection from his Spanish patron. With great austerity Don Ramon pointed out that this trifling with the entrails of the earth was not only an indignity to nature almost equal to shaft sinking and tunneling, but was a disturbance of vested interests. I and my fathers, San Diego rest them, said Don Ramon, crossing himself, were content with wells and cisterns, filled by heaven at its appointed seasons. The cattle, dumb brutes though they were, knew where to find water when they wanted it. But thou sayest truly, he added, with a sigh, that was before streams and rain were choked with hellish engines, and poisoned with their spume. Go on, friend Mulratty, dig and bore if thou wilt, but in a seemly fashion, and not with impious earthquakes of devilish gunpowder. With this concession Alvin Mulratty began to sink his first artesian shaft. Being debarred the auxiliaries of steam and gunpowder, the work went on slowly. The market garden did not suffer meantime, as Mulratty had employed two Chinese men to take charge of the ruder tillage, while he superintended the engineering work of the well. This trifling incident marked an epoch in the social condition of the family. Mrs. Mulratty at once assumed a conscious importance among her neighbors. She spoke of her husband's men, she alluded to the well as the works, she checked the easy frontier familiarity of her customers with pretty Mary Mulratty, her 17-year-old daughter. Simple Alvin Mulratty looked with astonishment at this sudden development of the germ planted in all feminine nature to expand in the slightest sunshine of prosperity. Look here, Malviny, ain't ye rather puttin' on airs with the boys that want to be civil to Mamie? Like as not one of em may be makin' up to her already. You don't mean to say, Alvin Mulratty, responded Mrs. Mulratty, with sudden severity, that you ever thought of giving your daughter to a common miner, or that I'm going to allow her to marry out of our own set. Our own set, echoed Mulratty feebly, blinking at her in astonishment, and then glancing hurriedly across at his freckle-faced son and the two chin-a men at work in the cabbages. Oh, you know what I mean, said Mrs. Mulratty sharply, the set that we move in. The Alvarados and their friends. Doesn't the old Don come here every day, and ain't his son the right age for Mamie? And ain't they the real first families here all the same as if they were noblemen? No, leave Mamie to me, and keep to your shaft, there never was a man yet had the least savé about these things, or knew what was due to his family. Like most of his larger-minded, but feebler-equipped sex, Mulratty was too glad to accept the truth of the latter proposition, which left the meannesses of life to feminine manipulation, and went off to his shaft on the hillside. But during that afternoon he was perplexed and troubled. He was too loyal a husband not to be pleased with this proof of an unexpected and superior foresight in his wife, although he was, like all husbands, a little startled by it. He tried to dismiss it from his mind. But looking down from the hillside upon his little venture, where gradual increase and prosperity had not been beyond his faculties to control and understand, he found himself haunted by the more ambitious projects of his helpmate. From his own knowledge of men, he doubted if Don Ramon, any more than himself, had ever thought of the possibility of a matrimonial connection between the families. He doubted if he would consent to it. And unfortunately it was this very doubt that, touching his own pride as a self-made man, made him first seriously consider his wife's proposition. He was as good as Don Ramon, any day. With this subtle feminine poison instilled in his veins, carried completely away by the logic of his wife's illogical premises, he almost hated his old benefactor. He looked down upon the little Garden of Eden, where his Eve had just tempted him with the fatal fruit, and felt a curious consciousness that he was losing its simple and innocent enjoyment forever. Happily, about this time Don Ramon died. It is not probable that he ever knew the amiable intentions of Mrs. Mulratty in regard to his son, who now succeeded to the paternal estate, sadly partitioned by relatives and lawsuits. The feminine Mulrattys attended the funeral, in expensive mourning from Sacramento. Even the gentle Alvin was forced into ready-made broadcloth, which accented his good-natured but unmistakably common presence. Mrs. Mulratty spoke openly of her loss, declared that the old families were dying out, and impressed the wives of a few new arrivals at Red Dog with the belief that her own family was contemporary with the Alvarados, and that her husband's health was far from perfect. She extended a motherly sympathy to the orphan Don Caesar. Reserved, like his father, in natural disposition, he was still more gravely ceremonious from his loss, and, perhaps from the shyness of an evident partiality for Mamie Mulratty, he rarely availed himself of her mother's sympathizing hospitality. But he carried out the intentions of his father by consenting to sell to Mulratty, for a small sum, the property he had leased. The idea of purchasing had originated with Mrs. Mulratty. "It'll be all in the family," had observed that astute lady, "and it's better for the looks of the things that we shouldn't he his tenants." It was only a few weeks later that she was startled by hearing her husband's voice calling her from the hillside as he rapidly approached the house. Mamie was in her room putting on a new pink cotton gown, in honor of an expected visit from young Don Caesar, and Mrs. Mulratty was tidying the house in view of the same event. Something in the tone of her good man's voice, and the unusual circumstance of his return to the house before work was done, caused her, however, to drop her dusting cloth, and run to the kitchen door to meet him. She saw him running through the rows of cabbages, his face shining with perspiration and excitement, a light in his eyes which she had not seen for years. She recalled, without sentiment, that he looked like that when she had called him a poor farmhand of her father's out of the brush heap at the back of their former home, in Illinois, to learn the consent of her parents. The recollection was the more embarrassing as he threw his arms around her, and pressed a resounding kiss upon her sallow cheek. "Sakes alive! Mulratty," she said, exorcising the ghost of a blush that had also been recalled from the past with her housewife's apron, "What are you doing?" and company expected every minute. "Malviny, I've struck it, and struck it rich." She disengaged herself from his arms without excitement and looked at him with bright but shrewdly observant eyes. "I've struck it in the well, the regular vein that the boys have been looking for. There's a fortin for you and Mamie, thousands and tens of thousands. Wait a minute." She left him quickly, and went to the foot of the stairs. He could hear her wonderingly and distinctly. "Ye can take off that new frock, Mamie," she called out. There was a sound of undisguised expostulation from Mamie. "I'm speaking," said Mrs. Mulratty, emphatically. The murmuring ceased. Mrs. Mulratty returned to her husband. The interruption seemed to have taken off the keen edge of his enjoyment. He at once abdicated his momentary elevation as a discoverer, and waited for her to speak. "Ye haven't told anyone yet?" she asked. "No. I was alone, down in the shaft. Ye see, Malviny, I wasn't expectin' of anything," he began, with an attempt at fresh enjoyment. "I was just clearin' out, and hadn't reckoned on anything." "You see, I was right when I advised you taking the land," she said, without heeding him. Mulratty's face fell. "I hope Don Caesar won't think," he began, hesitatingly. "I reckon, perhaps, I oughter make some sorter compensation, you know." "Stuff," said Mrs. Mulratty, decidedly. "Don't be a fool. Any gold discovery, anyhow, would have been yours, that's the law. And you bought the land without any restrictions. Besides, you never had any idea of this." She stopped, and looked him suddenly in the face. "Had you?" Mulratty opened his honest, pale gray eyes widely. "Why, Malviny. You know I hadn't. I could swear." "Don't swear, and don't let on to anybody but what you did know it was there. Now, Alvin Mulratty, listen to me." Her voice here took the strident form of action. "Knock off work at the shaft, and send your man away at once. Put on your things, catch the next stage to Sacramento at 4 o'clock, and take Mamie with you." "Mamie," echoed Mulratty, feebly. "You want to see Lawyer Cole and my brother Jim at once," she went on, without heeding him, "and Mamie wants a change and some proper clothes? Leave the rest to me and Abner. I'll break it to Mamie, and get her ready." Mulratty passed his hands through his tangled hair, wet with perspiration. He was proud of his wife's energy and action. He did not dream of opposing her, but somehow he was disappointed. The charming glamour and joy of his discovery had vanished before he could fairly dazzle her with it, or, rather, she was not dazzled with it at all. It had become like business, and the expression "breaking it to Mamie" jarred upon him. He would have preferred to tell her himself, to watch the color come into her delicate oval face, to have seen her soft eyes light with an innocent joy he had not seen in his wife's, and he felt a sinking conviction that his wife was the last one to awaken it. "You ain't got any time to lose," she said, impatiently, as he hesitated. Perhaps it was her impatience that struck harshly upon him. Perhaps, if she had not accepted her good fortune so confidently, he would not have spoken what was in his mind at the time, but he said gravely, "Wait a minute, Malviny, I've something to tell you about this find of mine that's singlar." "Go on," she said, quickly. "Lying among the rotten quartz of the vein was a pick," he said, constrainedly, and the face of the vein sorter looked easy if it had been worked at. Following the line outside to the base of the hill there was signs of there having been an old tunnel, but it had fallen in, and was blocked up. "Well," said Mrs. Mulratty, contemptuously. "Well," returned her husband, somewhat disconnectedly, "it kinder looked as if some feller might have discovered it before. And went away, and left it for others." "That's likely, ain't it?" interrupted his wife, with ill-disguised intolerance. "Everybody knows the hill wasn't worth that for prospectin', and it was abandoned when we came here. It's your property and you've paid for it. Are you going to wait to advertise for the owner, Alvin Mulratty, or are you going to Sacramento at 4 o'clock today? Mulratty started. He had never seriously believed in the possibility of a previous discovery, but his conscientious nature had prompted him to give it a fair consideration. She was probably right. What he might have thought had she treated it with equal conscientiousness he did not consider. All right, he said simply. I reckon we'll go at once. And when you talk to Lawyer Cole and Jim, keep that silly stuff about the pick to yourself. There's no use of putting queer ideas into other people's heads because you happen to have them yourself. When the hurried arrangements were at last completed, and Mr. Mulratty and Mamie, accompanied by a taciturn and discreet Chinaman, carrying their scant luggage, were on their way to the high road to meet the upstage, the father gazed somewhat anxiously and wistfully into his daughter's face. He had looked forward to those few moments to enjoy the freshness and naivete of Mamie's youthful delight and enthusiasm as a relief to his wife's practical, far-sighted realism. There was a pretty pink suffusion in her delicate cheek, the breathless happiness of a child in her half-opened little mouth, and a beautiful absorption in her large gray eyes that augured well for him. Well, Mamie, how do we like Bain and Eris? How do we like laying over all the gals between this and Frisco? Et. She had not heard him. The tender beautiful eyes were engaged in an anticipatory examination of the remembered shelves in the fancy emporium at Sacramento, in reading the admiration of the clerks, in glancing down a little criticizingly at the broad cowhide brogues that strode at her side, in looking up the road for the stagecoach, in regarding the fit of her new gloves everywhere but in the loving eyes of the man beside her. He, however, repeated the question, touched with her charming preoccupation, and passing his arm around her little waist. I like it well enough, Pa, you know, she said, slightly disengaging his arm, but adding a perfunctory little squeeze to his elbow to soften the separation. I always had an idea something would happen. I suppose I'm looking like a fright, she added, but Ma made me hurry to get away before Don Caesar came. And you didn't want to go without seeing him, he added, archly. I didn't want him to see me in this frock, said Mamie, simply. I reckon that's why Ma made me change, she added, with a slight laugh. Well, I reckon you're a loose good enough for him in any dress, said Mulratty, watching her attentively, and more than a match for him now, he added, triumphantly. I don't know about that, said Mamie. He's been rich all the time, and his father and grandfather before him, while we've been poor and his tenants. His face changed, the look of bewilderment, with which he had followed her words, gave way to one of pain, and then of anger. Did he get off such stuff as that? He asked, quickly. No. I'd like to catch him at it, responded Mamie, promptly. There's better nor him to be had for the asking now. They had walked on a few moments in aggrieved silence, and the Chinaman might have imagined some misfortune had just befallen them. But Mamie's teeth shone again between her parted lips. La, Pa, it ain't that. He cares everything for me, and I do for him, and if Ma hadn't got new ideas, she stopped suddenly. What new ideas? Queried her father, anxiously. Oh, nothing. I wish, Pa, you'd put on your other boots. Everybody can see these are made for the pharaohs. And you ain't a market gardener anymore. What am I, then? Asked Mulratty, with a half-pleased, half-uneasy laugh. You're a capitalist, I say, but Ma says a landed proprietor. Nevertheless, the landed proprietor, when he reached the boulder on the Red Dog Highway, sat down in somewhat moody contemplation, with his head bowed over the broad cowhide brogues, that seemed to have already gathered enough of the soil to indicate his right to that title. Mamie, who had recovered her spirits, but had not lost her preoccupation, wandered off by herself in the meadow, or ascended the hillside, as her occasional impatience at the delay of the coach, or the following of some ambitious fancy, alternately prompted her. She was so far away at one time that the stagecoach, which finally drew up before Mulratty, was obliged to wait for her. when she was deposited safely inside, and Mulratty had climbed to the box beside the driver, the latter remarked, curtly, "Ye gave me a right smart skeer, a minute ago, stranger. Easy how? Well, about 3 years ago, I was coming down this yer grade, at just this time, and sitting right on that stone, in just your attitude, was a man about your build and years. I pulled up to let him in, when, darn my skin. If he ever moved, but sorter looked at me without speaking. I called to him, and he never answered, except with that idiotic stare. I then let him have my opinion of him, in mighty strong English, and drove off, leaving him there. The next morning, when I came by on the up trip, darn my skin. If he wasn't there, but lying all of a heap on the boulder. Jim drops down and picks him up. Dr. Duchesne, easy was along, aloused it was a played-out prospector, with a big case of paralysis, and we expressed him through to the county hospital, like so much dead freight. I've always been kinder superstitious about passing that rock, and when I saw you just now, sitting there, dazed like, with your head down like the other chap, it rather threw me off my center. In the inexplicable and half-superstitious uneasiness that this coincidence awakened in Mulratty's unimaginative mind, he was almost on the point of disclosing his good fortune to the driver, in order to prove how preposterous was the parallel, but checked himself in time. "Did you find out who he was?" broke in a rash passenger. "Did you ever get over it?" added another unfortunate. With a pause of insulting scorn at the interruption, the driver resumed, pointedly, to Mulratty, "The pint of the whole thing was my cussin' a helpless man, easy could neither cuss back nor shoot, and then afterwards talking you for his ghost layin' for me to get even." He paused again, and then added, carelessly, "They say he never came to enough to let on who he was or where he came from, and he was eventually taken to asylum for doddering idiots and general and promiscuous imbeciles at Sacramento. I've heard it's considered a first-class institution, not only for them easy is paralyzed and can't talk, as for them easy is the reverse and is too chipper. Now," he added, languidly turning for the first time to his miserable questioners, "how did you find it?" Chapter 2. When the news of the discovery of gold in Mulratty Shaft was finally made public, it created an excitement hitherto unknown in the history of the country. Half of Red Dog and all Rough and Ready were emptied upon the yellow hill surrounding Mulratty's, until their circling campfires looked like a besieging army that had invested his peaceful pastoral home, preparatory to carrying it by assault. Unfortunately for them, they found the various points of vantage already garrisoned with notices of preemption for mining purposes in the name of the various members of the Alvarado family. This stroke of business was due to Mrs. Mulratty, as a means of mollifying the conscientious scruples of her husband and of placating the Alvarados, in view of some remote contingency. It is but fair to say that this degradation of his father's Castilian principles was opposed by Don Caesar. "You needn't work them yourself, but sell out to them that will, it's the only way to keep the prospectors from taking it without paying for it at all," argued Mrs. Mulratty. Don Caesar finally assented, perhaps less to the business arguments of Mulratty's wife than to the simple suggestion of Mamie's mother. Enough that he realized a sum in money for a few acres that exceeded the last 10 years' income of Don Ramon's 7 leagues. Equally unprecedented and extravagant was the realization of the discovery in Mulratty's shaft. It was alleged that a company, hastily formed in Sacramento, paid him $1 million down, leaving him still a controlling 2/3 interest in the mine. With an obstinacy, however, that amounted almost to a moral conviction, he refused to include the house and potato patch in the property. When the company had yielded the point, he declined, with equal tenacity, to part with it to outside speculators on even the most extravagant offers. In vain Mrs. Mulratty protested, in vain she pointed out to him that the retention of the evidence of his former humble occupation was a green blot upon their social escutcheon. "If you will keep the land, build on it, and root up the garden." But Mulratty was adamant. "It's the only thing I ever made myself, and got out of the soil with my own hands, It's the beginning of my fortune, and it may be the end of it. Maybe I'll be glad enough to have it to come back to some day, and be thankful for the square meal I can dig out of it. By repeated pressure, however, Mulratty yielded the compromise that a portion of it should be made into a vineyard and flower garden, and by a suitable coloring of ornament and luxury obliterate its vulgar part. Less successful, however, was that energetic woman in another effort to mitigate the austerities of their earlier state. It occurred to her to utilize the softer accents of Don Caesar in the pronunciation of their family name, and privately had Mulraid take the place of Mulratty on her visiting card. It might be Spanish, she argued with her husband. Lawyer Cole says most American names are corrupted, and how do you know that yours ain't? Mulratty, who would not swear that his ancestors came from Ireland to the Carolinas in 98, was helpless to refute the assertion. But the terrible nemesis of an un-Spanish, American provincial speech avenged the orthographical outrage at once. When Mrs. Mulratty began to be addressed orally, as well as by letter, as Mrs. Mulraid, and when simple amatory effusions to her daughter rhymed with lovely maid, she promptly refused the original vowel. But she fondly clung to the Spanish courtesy which transformed her husband's baptismal name, and usually spoke of him in his absence as Don Alvino. But in the presence of his short, square figure, his orange tawny hair, his twinkling gray eyes, and retroussé nose, even that dominant woman withheld his title. It was currently reported at Red Dog that a distinguished foreigner had one day approached Mulratty with the formula, "I believe I have the honor of addressing Don Alvino Mulratty." "You can bet your boots, stranger, that's me," had returned that simple Hidalgo. Although Mrs. Mulratty would have preferred that Mamie should remain at Sacramento until she could join her, preparatory to a trip to the States and Europe, she yielded to her daughter's desire to astonish Rough and Ready, before she left, with her new wardrobe, and unfold in the parent nest the delicate and painted wings with which she was to fly from them forever. "I don't want them to remember me afterwards in those spotted prints, Ma, and like as not say I never had a decent frock until I went away." There was something so like the daughter of her mother in this delicate foresight that the touched and gratified parent kissed her, and assented. The result was gratifying beyond her expectation. In that few weeks' sojourn at Sacramento, the young girl seemed to have adapted and assimilated herself to the latest modes of fashion with even more than the usual American girl's pliancy and taste. Equal to all emergencies of style and material, she seemed to supply, from some hitherto unknown quality she possessed, the grace and manner peculiar to each. Untrammeled by tradition, education, or precedent, she had the Western girl's confidence in all things being possible, which made them so often probable. Mr. Mulratty looked at his daughter with mingled sentiments of pride and awe. Was it possible that this delicate creature, so superior to him that he seemed like a degenerate scion of her remoter race, was his own flesh and blood? Was she the daughter of her mother, who even in her remembered youth was never equipped like this? If the thought brought no pleasure to his simple, loving nature, it at least spared him the pain of what might have seemed ingratitude in one more akin to himself. "The fact is, we ain't quite up to her style," was his explanation and apology. A vague belief that in another and a better world than this he might approximate and understand this perfection somewhat soothed and sustained him. It was quite consistent, therefore, that the embroidered cambric dress which Mamie Mulratty wore one summer afternoon on the hillside at Los Gatos, while to the critical feminine eye at once artistic and expensive, should not seem incongruous to her surroundings or to herself in the eyes of a general audience. It certainly did not seem so to one pair of frank, humorous ones that glanced at her from time to time, as their owner, a young fellow of 25, walked at her side. He was the new editor of the Rough and Ready Record, and, having been her fellow passenger from Sacramento, had already once or twice availed himself of her father's invitation to call upon them. Mrs. Mulratty had not discouraged this mild flirtation. Whether she wished to disconcert Don Caesar for some occult purpose, or whether, like the rest of her sex, she had an overweening confidence in the unheroic, unseductive, and purely platonic character of masculine humor, did not appear. When I say I'm sorry you are going to leave us, Miss Mulratty, said the young fellow, lightly, you will comprehend my unselfishness, since I frankly admit your departure would be a positive relief to me as an editor and a man. The pressure in the poet's corner of the Record since it was mistakenly discovered that a person of your name might be induced to seek the glade and shade without being afraid, dismayed, or betrayed, has been something enormous, and, unfortunately, I am debarred from rejecting anything, on the just ground that I am myself an interested admirer. It's dreadful to be placarded around the country by one's own full name, isn't it? Said Mamie, without, however, expressing much horror in her face. They think it much more respectful than to call you Mamie, he responded, lightly, and many of your admirers are middle-aged men, with a medieval style of compliment. I've discovered that amatory verifying wasn't entirely a youthful passion. Colonel Cash is about as fatal with a couplet as with a double-barreled gun, and scatters as terribly. Judge Butts and Dr. Wilson have both discerned the resemblance of your gifts to those of Venus, and their own to Apollo. But don't undervalue those tributes, Miss Mulratty, he added, more seriously. You'll have thousands of admirers where you are going, but you'll be willing to admit in the end, I think, that none were more honest and respectful than your subjects at Rough and Ready and Red Dog. He stopped, and added in a graver tone, does Don Caesar write poetry? He has something better to do, said the young lady, pertly. I can easily imagine that, he returned, mischievously, it must be a pallid substitute for other opportunities. What did you come here for? She asked, suddenly. To see you. Nonsense. You know what I mean. Why did you ever leave Sacramento to come here? I should think it would suit you so much better than this place. I suppose I was fired by your father's example, and wished to find a gold mine. Men like you never do, she said, simply. Is that a compliment, Miss Mulratty? I don't know. But I think that you think that it is. He gave her the pleased look of one who had unexpectedly found a sympathetic intelligence. Do I? This is interesting. Let's sit down. In their desultory rambling they had reached, quite unconsciously, the large boulder at the roadside. Mamie hesitated a moment, looked up and down the road, and then, with an already opulent indifference to the damaging of her spotless skirt, sat herself upon it, with her furled parasol held by her two little hands thrown over her half-drawn-up knee. The young editor, half-sitting, half-leaning, against the stone, began to draw figures in the sand with his cane. On the contrary, Miss Mulratty, I hope to make some money here. You are leaving Rough and Ready because you are rich. We are coming to it because we are poor. We, echoed Mamie, lazily, looking up the road. Yes. My father and two sisters. I am sorry. I might have known them if I hadn't been going away. At the same moment, it flashed across her mind that, if they were like the man before her, they might prove disagreeably independent and critical. Is your father in business? She asked. He shook his head. After a pause, he said, punctuating his sentences with the point of his stick in the soft dust, he is paralyzed, and out of his mind, Miss Mulratty. I came to California to seek him, as all news of him ceased 3 years since, and I found him only 2 weeks ago, alone, friendless and unrecognized pauper in the county hospital. 2 weeks ago? That was when I went to Sacramento. Very probably. It must have been very shocking to you. It was. I should think you'd feel real bad. I do, at times. He smiled, and laid his stick on the stone. You now see, Miss Mulratty, how necessary to me is this good fortune that you don't think me worthy of. Meantime I must try to make a home for them at Rough and Ready. Miss Mulratty put down her knee and her parasol. We mustn't stay here much longer, you know. Why? Why, the stagecoach comes by at about this time. And you think the passengers will observe us sitting here? Of course they will. Miss Mulratty, I implore you to stay. He was leaning over her with such apparent earnestness of voice and gesture that the color came into her cheek. For a moment she scarcely dared to lift her conscious eyes to his. When she did so, she suddenly glanced her own aside with a flash of anger. He was laughing. If you have any pity for me, do not leave me now, he repeated. Stay a moment longer, and my fortune is made. The passengers will report us all over Red Dog as engaged. I shall be supposed to be in your father's secrets, and shall be sought after as a director of all the new companies. The Record will double its circulation, poetry will drop out of its columns, advertising rush to fill its place, and I shall receive $5 a week more salary, if not 7.5. Never mind the consequences to yourself at such a moment. I assure you there will be none. You can deny it the next day, I will deny it, nay, more, the Record itself will deny it in an extra edition of 1,000 copies, at 10 cents each. Linger a moment longer, Miss Mulratty. Fly, oh fly, not yet. They're coming, hark. Oh. By Jove, it's only Don Caesar. It was, indeed, only the young scion of the House of Alvarado, blue-eyed, sallow-skinned, and high-shouldered, coming towards them on a fiery, half-broken Mustang, whose very spontaneous lawlessness seemed to accentuate and bring out the grave and decorous ease of his rider. Even in his burlesque preoccupation, the editor of the Record did not withhold his admiration of this perfect horsemanship. Mamie, who, in her wounded amour propre, would like to have made much of it to annoy her companion, was thus estopped any ostentatious compliment. Don Caesar lifted his hat with sweet seriousness to the lady, with grave courtesy to the gentleman. While the lower half of the centaur was apparently quivering with fury, and stamping the ground in his evident desire to charge upon the pair, the upper half, with natural dignity, looked from the one to the other, as if to leave the privilege of an explanation with them. But Mamie was too wise, and her companion too indifferent, to offer one. A slight shade passed over Don Caesar's face. To complicate the situation at that moment, the expected stagecoach came rattling by. With quick feminine intuition, Mamie caught in the faces of the driver and the expressman, and reflected in the mischievous eyes of her companion, a peculiar interpretation of their meeting, that was not removed by the whispered assurance of the editor that the passengers were anxiously looking back to see the shooting. The young Spaniard, equally oblivious of humor or curiosity, remained impassive. You know Mr. Slynn, of the Record, said Mamie, don't you? Don Caesar had never before met the Seigneur Slynn. He was under the impression that it was a Seigneur Robinson that was of the Record. Oh, he was shot, said Slynn. I'm taking his place. Bueno. To be shot too? I trust not. Slynn looked quickly and sharply into Don Caesar's grave face. He seemed to be incapable of any double meaning. However, as he had no serious reason for awakening Don Caesar's jealousy, and very little desire to become an embarrassing third in this conversation, and possibly a burden to the young lady, he proceeded to take his leave of her. From a sudden feminine revulsion of sympathy, or from some unintelligible instinct of diplomacy, Mamie said, as she extended her hand, I hope you'll find a home for your family near here. Mama wants Pa to let our old house. Perhaps it might suit you, if not too far from your work. You might speak to Ma about it? Thank you, I will, responded the young man, pressing her hand with unaffected cordiality. Don Caesar watched him until he had disappeared behind the wayside buckeyes. He is a man of family, this one, your countryman. It seemed strange to her to have a mere acquaintance spoken of as her countryman, not the first time nor the last time in her career. As there appeared no trace or sign of jealousy in her questioner's manner, she answered briefly but vaguely. Yes, it's a shocking story. His father disappeared some years ago, and he has just found him a helpless paralytic in the Sacramento hospital. He'll have to support him, and they're very poor. So, then, they are not independent of each other always, these fathers and children of Americans. No, said Mamie, shortly. Without knowing why, she felt inclined to resent Don Caesar's manner. His serious gravity, gentle and high-bred as it was, undoubtedly was somewhat trying to her at times, and seemed even more so after Slynn's irreverent humor. She picked up her parasol, a little impatiently, as if to go. But Don Caesar had already dismounted, and tied his horse to a tree with a strong lariat that hung at his saddle bow. "Let us walk through the woods towards your home. I can return alone for the horse when you shall dismiss me." They turned in among the pines that, overcrowding the hollow, crept partly up the side of the hill of Mulratty's Shaft. A disused trail, almost hidden by the waxen-hued yerba buena, led from the highway, and finally lost itself in the undergrowth. It was a lover's walk, they were lovers, evidently, and yet the man was too self-poised in his gravity, the young woman too conscious and critical, to suggest an absorbing or oblivious passion. "I should not have made myself so obtrusive today before your friend," said Don Caesar, with proud humility, "but I could not understand from your mother whether you were alone or whether my company was desirable. It is of this I have now to speak, Mamie. Lately your mother has seemed strange to me, avoiding any reference to our affection, treating it lightly, and even as today, I fancy, putting obstacles in the way of our meeting alone. She was disappointed at your return from Sacramento where, I have been told, she intended you to remain until you left the country, and since your return I have seen you but twice. I may be wrong. Perhaps I do not comprehend the American mother. I have, who knows, perhaps offended in some point of etiquette, omitted some ceremony that was her due. But when you told me, Mamie, that it was not necessary to speak to her first, that it was not the American fashion." Mamie started, and blushed slightly. "Yes," she said hurriedly, "certainly, but Ma has been quite queer of late, and she may think, you know, that since there has been so much property to dispose of, she ought to have been consulted." "Then let us consult her at once, dear child. And as to the property, in heaven's name, let her dispose of it as she will. Saints forbid that an Alvarado should ever interfere. And what is it to us, my little one? Enough that Dona Mamita Alvarado will never have less state than the richest bride that ever came to Los Gatos." Mamie had not forgotten that, scarcely a month ago, even had she loved the man before her no more than she did at present, she would still have been thrilled with delight at these words. Even now she was moved, conscious as she had become that the state of a bride of the Alvarados was not all she had imagined, and that the bare adobe court of Los Gatos was open to the sky and the free criticism of Sacramento capitalists. "Yes, dear," she murmured with a half-childlike pleasure, that lit up her face and eyes so innocently that it stopped any minute investigation into its origin and real meaning. "Yes, dear, but we need not have a fuss made about it at present, and perhaps put Ma against us. She wouldn't hear of our marrying now, and she might forbid our engagement. But you are going away." "I should have to go to New York or Europe first, you know," she answered, naively, "even if it were all settled. I should have to get things. One couldn't be decent here." With the recollection of the pink cotton gown, in which she had first pledged her troth to him, before his eyes, he said, "But you are charming now. You cannot be more so to me. If I am satisfied, little one, with you as you are, let us go together, and then you can get dresses to please others." She had not expected this importunity. Really, if it came to this, she might have engaged herself to someone like Slynn, he at least would have understood her. He was much cleverer, and certainly more of a man of the world. When Slynn had treated her like a child, it was with the humorous tolerance of an admiring superior, and not the didactic impulse of a guardian. She did not say this, nor did her pretty eyes indicate it, as in the instance of her brief anger with Slynn. She only said gently, "I should have thought you, of all men, would have been particular about your wife doing the proper thing. But never mind. Don't let us talk any more about it. Perhaps as it seems such a great thing to you, and so much trouble, there may be no necessity for it at all. I do not think that the young lady deliberately planned this charmingly illogical deduction from Don Caesar's speech, or that she calculated its effect upon him, but it was part of her nature to say it, and profit by it. Under the unjust lash of it, his pride gave way. "Ah, do you not see why I wish to go with you?" he said, with sudden and unexpected passion. "You are beautiful, you are good, it has pleased heaven to make you rich also, but you are a child in experience, and know not your own heart. With your beauty, your goodness, and your wealth, you will attract all to you as you do here because you cannot help it. But you will be equally helpless, little one, if they should attract you, and you had no tie to fall back upon." It was an unfortunate speech. The words were Don Caesar's, but the thought she had heard before from her mother, although the deduction had been of a very different kind. Mamie followed the speaker with bright but visionary eyes. There must be some truth in all this. Her mother had said it, Mr. Slynn had laughingly admitted it. She had a brilliant future before her. Was she right in making it impossible by a rash and foolish tie? He himself had said she was inexperienced. She knew it, and yet, what was he doing now but taking advantage of that inexperience? If he really loved her, he would be willing to submit to the test. She did not ask a similar one from him, and was willing, if she came out of it free, to marry him just the same. There was something so noble in this thought that she felt for a moment carried away by an impulse of compassionate unselfishness, and smiled tenderly as she looked up in his face. "Then you consent, Mamie," he said, eagerly, passing his arm around her waist. "Not now, Caesar," she said, gently disengaging herself. "I must think it over, we are both too young to act upon it rashly, it would be unfair to you, who are so quiet and have seen so few girls, I mean Americans, to tie yourself to the first one you have known. When I am gone you will go more into the world. There are Mr. Slynn's two sisters coming here. I shouldn't wonder if they were far cleverer and talked far better than I do, and think how I should feel if I knew that only a wretched pledge to me kept you from loving them." She stopped, and cast down her eyes. It was her first attempt at coquetry, for, in her usual charming selfishness, she was perfectly frank and open, and it might not have been her last, but she had gone too far at first, and was not prepared for a recoil of her own argument. "If you admit that it is possible, that it is possible to you," he said, quickly. She saw her mistake. "We may not have many opportunities to meet alone," she answered, quietly, "and I am sure we would be happier when we meet not to accuse each other of impossibilities. Let us rather see how we can communicate together, if anything should prevent our meeting. Remember, it was only by chance that you were able to see me now. If Ma has believed that she ought to have been consulted, our meeting together in this secret way will only make matters worse. She is even now wondering where I am, and may be suspicious. I must go back at once. At any moment someone may come here looking for me. But I have so much to say," he pleaded. "Our time has been so short. You can write. But what will your mother think of that?" he said, in grave astonishment. She colored again as she returned, quickly, "Of course, you must not write to the house. You can leave a letter somewhere for me, say, somewhere about here. Stop," she added, with a sudden girlish gaiety, "see, here's the very place. Look there." She pointed to the decayed trunk of a blasted sycamore, a few feet from the trail. A cavity, breast high, half filled with skeleton leaves and pine nuts, showed that it had formerly been a squirrel's hoard, but for some reason had been deserted. "Look, it's a regular letterbox," she continued, gaily, rising on tiptoe to peep into its recesses. Don Caesar looked at her admiringly. It seemed like a return to their first idyllic lovemaking in the old days, when she used to steal out of the cabbage rows in her brown linen apron and sunbonnet to walk with him in the woods. He recalled the fact to her with the fatality of a lover already seeking to restore in past recollections something that was wanting in the present. She received it with the impatience of youth, to whom the present is all sufficient. I wonder how you could ever have cared for me in that Holland apron, she said, looking down upon her new dress. Shall I tell you why, he said, fondly, passing his arm around her waist, and drawing her pretty head nearer his shoulder. No, not now, she said, laughingly, but struggling to free herself. There's not time. Write it, and put it in the box. There, she added, hastily, listen, what's that? It's only a squirrel, he whispered reassuringly in her ear. No, it's somebody coming. I must go. Please. Caesar, dear. There, then. She met his kiss halfway, released herself with a lithe movement of her wrist and shoulder, and the next moment seemed to slip into the woods, and was gone. Don Caesar listened with a sigh as the last rustling ceased, cast a look at the decayed tree as if to fix it in his memory, and then slowly retraced his steps towards his tethered Mustang. He was right, however, in his surmise of the cause of that interruption. A pair of bright eyes had been watching them from the bough of an adjacent tree. It was a squirrel, who, having had serious and prior intentions of making use of the cavity they had discovered, had only withheld examination by an apparent courteous discretion towards the intruding pair. Now that they were gone, he slipped down the tree and ran towards the decayed stump.